Hi, welcome to Car Corner. My name is Richard Saxton, and I'm the curriculum coordinator here at the Automotive Technology Program at the Community College of Philadelphia. Today's episode, we're going to see a maintenance inspection on a 2003 Ford Mustang by Mr. Dan Reed. If you have any questions about your own car and you'd like us to answer them on air, please contact us at autotech@ccp.edu.
Hi, I'm Dan Reed with the Community College of Philadelphia's Automotive Technology Program. Welcome to Car Corner. Preventative maintenance is one of the easiest things you can do to make sure that your car lasts a very, very long time and runs smoothly. Let's start by taking a look at the brake fluid. This area on the driver's side, right up against this area known as the firewall, this is called the master cylinder. The master cylinder holds the brake fluid, which is used in the brake's hydraulic system. To check it, you're basically going to locate the maximum fill mark and make sure that it's filled. If not, you would simply take the cap off, add the proper brake fluid until it was right at the top level. If your brakes needed more work, or if you had a low fluid issue that kept coming back, that's a sign that there could be a problem with the brakes and you should have it looked at. Brake fluid comes in a couple different styles. You have to make sure you use the right one for your vehicle, otherwise you're going to damage something. The most basic type is DOT-3 brake fluid. DOT-3, DOT-4 is the standard for most cars in North America and around the world. There's another type of brake fluid which is called DOT-5. Now DOT-5 is a silicone-based brake fluid and it doesn't mix properly with DOT-3, DOT-4, so you cannot mix brake fluids. If you do happen to mix them, this is what's going to happen. You'll notice that the purple DOT-5 fluid is floating on top of the more clear DOT-3-4 fluid. If you're not sure of what type of brake fluid your car takes, you can always look at the master cylinder fill cap. By law, it has to say what type of fluid the car takes. The other thing you have to remember about brake fluid is that part of the job of brake fluid is that it has to work when it's very hot and it's very cold out, and more importantly, it absorbs water. That's one of the key jobs of the hydraulic system of the brakes. Over time, water will start to migrate into the fluid and you have to change your brake fluid. DOT-5 is a silicone-based brake fluid and it does not absorb water, but the problem is since it's not compatible with the DOT-3, DOT-4 fluid, you can't use it in your car. Finally, remember that DOT-3, DOT-4 brake fluid damages paint. So if you happen to spill some on the finish of the car, just wash it off with cold water and lots of it. The next thing we're going to do is we're going to check our motor oil. Most vehicles have a fairly easy to get to dipstick. To check the oil, make sure the car has been off, pull the dipstick out, and wipe it clean. What we're going to look for is we're looking for some type of marker. Now your owner's guide would have this information in it, but the oil level should basically be in between the minimum and the maximum mark. We don't want it over full, and we certainly don't want it under full. Both are actually just as bad. So let's put this back in, wait a second, and then pull it back out, carefully looking at the oil level. I can see that my oil level is right before the maximum mark, which means it's fine where it is. So we'll wipe that off and then reinsert it. If I needed to add oil, I could add it here in the valve cover. Some oil fill caps actually tell you the proper weight of the oil that the vehicle is supposed to take. When it comes to motor oil, making sure you use the right type of motor oil in your car is absolutely critical to the life of the engine. Motor oil comes in many different styles and what's known as different weights. An easy way to think about the weight of motor oil is think about how thick molasses would be when it's very cold. It's very thick. Cooking oil, on the other hand, is very thin once it gets heated. Motor oil has a really hard job. It has to work and flow when the engine is cold and also when the car is extremely hot. So the way you read an oil container is by looking at the numbers. You'll see the numbers that say something like 5W20. Now a lot of people mistake and they think the W stands for the word weight, which is wrong. It actually stands for the word winter. When you have a W motor oil, it means that it is a winter blended oil, which means that the motor oil, when it is cold out, will actually flow like a 5-weight, which is fairly thin. As the engine heats up, it will actually start to flow like a 20-weight. Now, if you try this yourself, you might not be able to see the flow change. However, it does in fact happen on a molecular level, and that's what the numbers mean. So we have different types of weights of motor oil. This motor oil over here, this is a fully synthetic motor oil, which means that it has no naturally occurring oils in it. It's made completely in a laboratory and is extremely expensive. But it has one big benefit. It has the ability to actually go down to extremely low temperatures and still flow well. This is what most new cars today take as a synthetic motor oil. If you have an older motor vehicle, your motor oil is going to be slightly different. This one is a 40-weight, 10W40, this is 10W30, and this is 5W20. If you're not sure as to what type of motor oil your car takes, some cars do in fact show the motor oil type on the oil fill cap. So since this car uses 5W20, I would pick this oil. If you use the wrong motor oil in the car, you run the risk of a couple different things. First of all, by using the wrong type of viscosity or lubricant in the vehicle, you're going to damage the internal engine components, cause leaks, possibly even engine noise and severe engine damage. So picking the right motor oil is critical. The second thing is make sure you buy a quality motor oil. One of these oils is an imposter, and in fact, it's not any good for your car. The way that you can tell is by looking for something known as the API seal of approval, which all of these oils should have. This one has it here, this one has it here. You notice this motor oil right here doesn't have that seal of approval and therefore isn't actually made for a car, even though it looks like it's supposed to. It's got a nice label on it and it's properly labeled, but it's not actually approved by the American Petroleum Industry for use in cars. This oil was a dollar at the dollar store, and you might be thinking that you got a great deal, but in reality you're trashing your engine. So now we're going to check the power steering fluid. This area down here on this vehicle is the power steering fluid reservoir. The cap actually contains the dipstick that's going to tell us exactly how much fluid we have to add. It's a little bit low, so we'll add some in a short bit. Again, like motor oil, there's many different types of power steering fluid that go in your vehicle, and you want to choose the right one. By adding the wrong power steering fluid to your vehicle, you run the risk of severe damage and expensive damage to the power steering system of the vehicle. A power steering rack, if it leaks, can cost thousands of dollars to replace. And the fact is I've seen people mess them up just by putting the wrong chemicals in them. So make sure you pay attention, look at your owner's guide, and make sure you add the right fluid. Some older products take what's known as Type F automatic transmission fluid. Type F is easy to remember because it's what most older Ford vehicles took. Here we have a generic fluid. I'm not a big fan of generic fluids because for the most part, well, they're generic, and your car isn't generic. It was designed by somebody, so you probably want to use the right type of fluid. This power steering fluid is designed for Hondas, and one critical thing about Hondas is that they use a different type of power steering fluid base than other manufacturers. I've seen lots of Hondas come into the shop with severe power steering problems just because somebody added the generic fluid to their Honda to save a few bucks, and it ended up costing them a whole lot more. Again, right here we have some other generic power steering fluid. I'm not a fan of that. Other types of power steering fluid may actually be good old-fashioned automatic transmission fluid. Automatic transmission fluid is a great hydraulic lubricant, and manufacturers used it for years in their power steering systems. To check your vehicle's power steering fluid, what you're going to do is you're going to look at the small dipstick that may be part of the power steering cap, or there may actually be marks on the fluid reservoir where the power steering goes. Make sure you look at your owner's guide to see whether the car needs to be hot or cold, running or stopped, before you add the fluid. And just remember, always add the right fluid. Next, we're going to move on to washer fluid. You're going to want to make sure that you use a good quality, proper washer solvent. Never add anything like ammonia or bleach to your washer fluid reservoir. It's going to destroy the car's finish, and it's also going to destroy the car's wiper blades. Proper washer fluid will also help prevent freezing in the winter, and in the summer, it'll help get bugs off the windshield. Next, let's move on to the battery. The battery of the vehicle is what is used to actually start the vehicle. The battery should be held down securely. If the battery is loose in any kind of a way, that is a problem because the battery itself will actually become damaged from vibrations down the road. The cables should be clean and tight. There should be no visible corrosion around the terminal areas. If there is, we can use a product to clean them. Engine coolant is used to help cool the vehicle as it goes down the road. It circulates through the vehicle's engine block just like a heating system in a house. To get to the coolant in the vehicle, before you open the cap, make sure that it's cool to the touch. Another trick is to make sure that the hoses are cool and also not under any type of pressure. If they are under pressure or if they are hot, do not open the fill cap because the cooling system is pressurized under usage. This system's cool, so we can take the cap off. Taking the cap off, you're going to inspect the underside of the cap, making sure that there's no white corrosion or any type of rust or scale built up on there. This one looks fine. However, this isn't actually where I check the fluid level to make sure that the coolant is at the proper level. That is done over here at this other reservoir that says radiator coolant only. The coolant that we would add actually goes into this tank. Now this tank is called an expansion tank, and what happens is when the vehicle warms up, excess fluid pressure comes out of the cap through this hose into this reservoir. This reservoir could be opened at any time. It's not under any type of pressure. So most manufacturers want you to add the coolant to the reservoir. There's a mark on the top side and the bottom side of the reservoir to tell us exactly when it's full and when it's empty. Coolant comes in a couple different styles. And just like the other chemicals in your car, you have to make sure you add the right one. The most common type of coolant is what's affectionately known as green coolant. This is what cars took for years. Later, we have what's known as orange coolant. Now, the orange coolant has been out for several years now and was first started by General Motors. Its large advantage was that it supposedly lasted longer than the green coolant. So people thought, well, gee, I should mix the orange coolant with the green coolant if my car already has the green coolant, and what that's going to do is give me the benefits of the orange. The problem is the two fluids aren't compatible. So you should never mix coolants unless you know exactly what you're doing. Now the Java coolant, also known as antifreeze, has several parts to its job. First is it obviously cools the vehicle. It circulates through like a heating system. The fluid is transferred as it heats up from the engine compartment out to the radiator where it radiates its heat and it releases its energy and then is recycled back into the engine where it cools the engine again. The other thing coolant does is it acts as antifreeze, as we all know it. Water, if you were to put it in a freezer inside a glass jar, would expand and crack the glass. The same thing could happen with the engine block in your car. So antifreeze is designed not to freeze except in extremely low temperatures, but it has to be mixed properly. The third thing coolant does is it actually acts as a chemical that is going to prevent acid from building up inside the engine. In a car battery, we have two different types of metals and then what's known as an electrolyte between the two. The two different metals in the electrolyte act together to create the electric current that starts your car. Your car's engine, however, is also typically made up of more than one metal. And what will happen is the coolant will become acidic, just like battery acid, and actually start to corrode the inside of the engine. So you want to make sure that your coolant is changed and checked often to make sure that you're not doing any type of internal engine damage. So the easiest way to check your coolant is to use a coolant tester. Now this is a professional coolant tester, and the way it works is these balls are going to float when I pull some coolant into it, and based on the number of balls that float, it's going to tell me the point at which it's going to freeze. So let's check our green coolant. Now what we want to see is we want to see all the balls floating except for the orange one. We want the orange one to sink. If the orange one is floating along with all the other balls, it means our coolant actually doesn't have enough water in it and it has too much coolant. That's a problem. People would think more is better. However, straight coolant actually freezes faster when it doesn't have water added to it. So we want to make sure that we have a proper, typically 50-50 mix of water and antifreeze in your car. So we'll squeeze that out. What you want to check when you buy coolant is you want to make sure that the coolant you're buying may or may not be pre-diluted for your car. So this coolant right here is actually pre-diluted. It's a 50% mixture of distilled water and then a 50% mixture of coolant. Let's check the orange coolant. It works the same way. Draw up the coolant. And again, they should all float except for the last ball, the orange ball. That should drop here in a second. And sure enough, it does. Now what this means is that this coolant is good until minus 34 degrees Fahrenheit. Again, make sure you remember that you use the right type of coolant for your vehicle, and you should never mix coolants no matter what anybody says. If you take care of the cooling system, you'll never have to use any type of radiator flush or cooling system additives. If you just maintain the chemicals the way they're supposed to be maintained, when they're supposed to be maintained, you won't run into a problem. The last part of the cooling system that's extremely easy to check and change is the radiator cap. Now this cap develops pressure in the cooling system. When we develop pressure in the cooling system, what that does is that actually raises the boiling point of the coolant. Water, as you may know, boils at about 212 degrees Fahrenheit. Coolant won't boil till about 230, and then if we pressurize it, it won't boil until about 250. So the actual cap itself has this pressure spring that works just like an old-fashioned pressure cooker, and this cap even says on it that it goes to 16 pounds of pressure. This is why it's extremely important not to remove a cap off a hot radiator, because what you're doing is you're taking 250 degree coolant and water and immediately exposing it to outside air, which will make it immediately boil and all come out of the radiator. If you happen to be in the way, it's extremely painful and will burn you severely. Let's take a look at the belts. This car has one single belt, which is known as a serpentine belt. It's called that because it's one continuous belt that runs all of the accessories on the vehicle. If you had an older vehicle, you might have remembered that it had several different belts that were much narrower. Those were called V-belts. The reason why manufacturers did away with them was because they were noisy and they always needed to be adjusted. The beauty of a serpentine belt is it has one tensioner on it that always keeps the proper tension on the belt. If the belt loosens up, the tensioner simply takes up the slack, and that keeps the belt nice and taut and nothing slips or makes any noise. A quick inspection of the belt is to make sure that the underside of the belt is not damaged in any way. The top part of the belt should be relatively smooth, and there should be no nicks or cuts or tears on the belt. If you see anything that looks like a piece of fabric that's fraying off of the belt, that's a sign that the belt has been damaged and it absolutely needs to be replaced. Most cars today have serpentine belts, which is one large belt that runs all of the accessories on the vehicle. So the quality of the belt is critical, because if the belt breaks, you're completely stranded. It's going to take out everything in the car. It's going to take out your alternator, which charges your battery, the power steering pump, your air conditioner, as well as probably the water pump in the vehicle. So you're pretty much stranded if this belt breaks. What I have here is a display showing some examples of damaged belts, and I also have some real belts to show you. Right here, we see that this section of the belt is completely gone. It's frayed. This gets caused by having the belt not be aligned with the other components. If this happens and you just replace the belt, chances are this problem is going to come right back again down the road. So you actually have to look at all the belt mounting hardware to make sure that it's on properly. This next one right here, we notice that we have some slight fraying across the edges, and this is due to one of the pulleys being damaged. Now, this can happen when somebody unfortunately works on the car improperly and they end up damaging one of the pulleys, and that's going to cause the belt itself to actually become damaged. Here we see that there's some grooves that are out of space from one another. These grooves are very narrow, these grooves are very wide. Again, this can be caused by having the pulleys be out of alignment. There's a lot of accessories on the vehicle, and it's very common for a vehicle to be involved with an accident or have a major component replaced. And if a bracket or mounting component gets bent or damaged, it's going to cause just this. This one right here, we have some swelling of the belt. Now that is caused usually by having oil contamination on the belt. Anytime that we have any type of fluid leak on the belt surface area, it's going to actually cause the rubber of the belt to deteriorate. So you want to make sure that any type of oil leak your car has is fixed before you go ahead and replace the belt. Otherwise, you're just going to coat your new belt with oil again. Here we see that we have the belt and there looks to be some type of debris embedded in the belt surface, and then the back side of the belt, which normally is smooth, has some damage done to it. This is caused by having debris, maybe sand, glass, anything like that that you drove through, and what happens is it actually gets embedded inside the surface of the belt. Well, this necessarily isn't a problem, but what'll happen is over time, those pieces of glass and sand will actually start to dig into the belt and destroy it. Over here, we have what's known as chunking. And what that means is that severe chunks of the center rib of the belt are starting to deteriorate. That's just a sign of age and the belt needs to be replaced. Here we have some cracking of the belt surface, and again, more severe chunking. In other words, actual whole pieces of the rib are completely missing from the belt. This is a problem. This is your typical belt that is well worn and just should be replaced, but it's not any due to any mechanical issues on the car. Maybe the car is just high mileage. And over here, we have some cracking on the belt. Now this is fairly common and should just be used as a guide that maybe you should start saving some money and think about replacing your belt in the near future. It doesn't need to be replaced now, but it's not soon until it starts to look like this belt, and then you have a real problem. This belt is severely cracked and it's frayed on the outside. The belt is made up of many layers of fiberglass and steel cord, and what happens is as the belt starts to disintegrate, the material starts to fray apart and the belt will crack and then eventually break. This belt right here shows a great example of what happens when the belt just starts to get aged. This belt was replaced at the proper point in time before it did any kind of damage, and more importantly, the belt didn't really cause a failure on the vehicle. It was replaced in time, so the person wasn't left stranded. Now right here, this is a new belt. And you'll notice that the belt, the grooves are extremely smooth. There's no cracking. If I hold it up against the old belt, you can clearly see the difference between the old belt and the new belt. So make sure you do yourself a favor and check your belt or belts, if your car has multiple ones, and replace them as needed. Let's take a look at the air filter. Most air filters are held in place with some small clips. You have to undo these clips before you can separate the box and actually get to the filter. Now, every manufacturer is different in the way that they do this. This car has a front half and a back half to the filter. I've undone the clips, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to lift the back part of the filter out so the front part will stay in, and the filter is actually in the front part of the housing. So I'm going to lift this out. And the first thing we're going to see is this screen right here. And we'll see that there's some wires that run into the air filter housing. This is called the mass air flow sensor. It's a very sensitive sensor. And what it does is it measures the amount of airflow that comes into the engine. That sensor works along with the car's computer to figure out exactly how much fuel to give the car. And in turn, that controls the amount of power and fuel economy you get. So don't touch that sensor. It's very fragile. Don't ever spray anything into the sensor either. Our air filter comes out like so. If the air filter were dirty, we'd see that pretty easily. Realize that the back side of the filter, the part that you normally don't see, this should be clean. The outside of the part should be dirty. Put that back in. When you reassemble the air box, make sure that all of the clips are put back together and that the box is perfectly sealed. If there's any type of air gap, you run the risk of sucking dirty air into the engine, which in turn is going to damage that sensor and, worse, actually damage the engine. Air filters come in a lot of different shapes and sizes. Now, before you go out and just pick one off the shelf, you're probably going to have to look in some type of chart or booklet that's going to tell you exactly what type of air filter your vehicle takes. you can see that all of these air filters are not the same. In fact, each one is for a different type of vehicle. So make sure that you take the time to look it up or have you help you look up the proper air filter for your vehicle before you spend money and buy it. When an air filter becomes dirty, what's happening is all of the air that's sucked into the engine goes through the filter. Now, normally for people, air filters aren't a big problem unless we're working in some type of dusty environment, then we're going to wear a mask. However, your car doesn't have that choice, so we put a mask on it all the time. When the air filter gets dirty, what will happen is that dust, debris, dirt, even oil will get trapped into the filter and prevent that from being sucked into the engine. If you could imagine dirt the size of a piece of aspirin, if you were to suck that into the engine while the car is running, that is the equivalent of about 100,000 miles worth of wear in your engine. So keeping dust and dirt out of the engine is extremely important for the life of the engine. This older square type filter is still pretty common. However, most cars today might use a round or what's known as a cone or bullet shaped filter. Now, the filters actually work the same way. They take the dirty air from the outside and then pass clean air into the inside of the engine. And that's all fine. Some types of air filters are a specialty type of air filter. This one, which has a reddish color to it, is what's known as a K&N, which is a brand name. Now, the advantage of a K&N air filter is that the filter can actually be washed out and cleaned. With these other types of air filters, when they're dirty, we throw them out. But by using a special cleaning kit that you buy separately from the air filter, it'll actually allow you to keep the air filter in the car for up to about 1,000,000 miles. The other advantage is that the manufacturer K&N claims that the air filter actually flows air better, which in turn translates into more power and better fuel economy. If you're going to keep your car for a long time, you might be better off spending the little bit of a premium for the K&N filter versus the paper filters, because if you're going to keep your car for at least 50 to 100,000 miles, this is going to actually wind up saving you money in the long run because you're not throwing out the filter each time you replace it. This filter is basically good for the life of the car. However, it does need to be cleaned periodically and you have to use the special cleaning kit to clean it. So remember, make sure to check and change your air filter probably about every 30,000 miles. You might even want to replace it at that point if it's dirty enough. Make sure you check your owner's guide to see exactly when they have to be done. Next, let's take a look at the automatic transmission. Now in this car, the dipstick is back here on the engine. What we're going to do is we're going to pull the stick out and take a look at it. Now, two conditions have to be met before you run a test on automatic transmission. First of all, the car has to be running. And second of all, it has to be warmed up. Now the reason why we have to do this is because there's a pump down in the automatic transmission, and if we put the stick in cold with the car not running, we're going to get a false fluid level. So let's put the stick in and then start the car. Pull the stick out and take our look, and we're right where we need to be. So we're good. So now that we've checked over all the basic fluids and the belts of the car, you should be good to go. If you do that about once a month, your car should last a good long time and get you on down the road. I'm Dan Reed. Thanks for watching Car Corner. Safe driving.